Hi, Phil Bedford here, the Rebel Network, and today I'm in Bahrain. And we're running a 4-day certified networker for the Bahraini Economic Department, and I'm here with Dr. Sayed Al Khalifa. He's a manager of investor relations for the Bahrain Economic Development Board. He's also a triathlete. And we were having a chat, and he's actually done his dissertation.
Yeah.
His dissertation was on trust in economic growth.
Yep.
Yeah. And he's just going to give us some tips from his thesis, because I thought it was just incredible. So,
well, see, the thing is, when I read a lot of literature in economics and in political economy, I felt like something was missing, and that thing was in political psychology. So psychology is very important, and when I see a lot of indicators that try to explain economic growth, I felt like there was something missing, which is the human aspect out of the significance of what actually makes people invest and make people actually go to the banks, go to the economy, go to the business sector, and that is what I felt was trust. Mm-hmm. So I took trust and I divided it into two, generalized and particularized, and I saw how important is particularized trust. And I saw that it had a significant importance and significant influence in the dependent variable, which is economic growth.
Wow. And you give me an example of how it applies to prisoners, I think you were saying.
Yeah. I tried to also prove it in a qualitative sense, which then I looked at the tit-for-tat strategy and the prisoner's dilemma, and how to get actually two prisoners to cooperate. And I found it in the tit-for-tat strategy where, you know, if they started cooperating, if you take this strategy again in two or three and more than one shot actually of a prisoner's dilemma, you will slowly notice that they will start cooperating in order for them to achieve the optimal equilibrium, not the suboptimal equilibrium, which is cooperation.
Do you have like an example of something that's happened in the world recently, which would be something like Cyprus, for example?
Yeah, for let's take Cyprus as an example. You see a lot of runoff from the banks. People want to take their money and run out right away, and the banks close to prevent that. Now, this actually issue from, let's say, from a Middle Eastern or an African sense, a lot of people understood what's happening, you know, because it's something that's easy that they understand, that's sort of not that comfortable to trust those kind of institutions. But from a Western perspective, you'd see that a lot of perception on this actual phenomenon that took place. A lot of people were scratching their heads, like, what's going on? Why do people do that? Why are the banks closing?
Okay, so if you had one tip to, very briefly, to help people build trust with, I don't know, overseas with organizations, what do you think that would be?
I'd say that it's very important to recognize that humans are not robots. Their relationship with each other is very important. They need to emotionally interact. They need to trust. And this does not happen in 1 second, it happens in time, it needs nurturing, and that actually leads to a lot of different benefits, including economic growth at a very national level.
Wow. So even companies need to build relationships and trust.
Exactly. Companies do that at every single level, but it definitely goes, it's consistent at an individual level, at a national level, and even at an international level. This model is consistent everywhere.
And if our countries could learn to build a little bit more trust and relationships, we'd be a lot better world.
Exactly, yes.
Brilliant.
Brilliant.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you. See you soon. Take care.